Now we're going to turn to the Federal Reserve. It begins its 2 days of meetings today in which it will be acting on a decision made last month as reflected in this statement from its minutes. And this is what they said, quote, the committee intends to continue to implement monetary policy in a regime in which an ample supply of reserves ensures that control over the level of the federal funds rate and other short-term interest rates is exercised primarily through the setting of the Federal Reserve's administered rates and in which, now listen to this, in which active management of the supply of reserves is not required.
An emphatic statement.
I read it carefully and I didn't understand it, so I went to Mike McKee, our international economics and policy correspondent, to explain exactly what all this means and why we should care about it. And he is here now to take us through exactly what it does mean. Mike?
Well, we're going to do Reserves 101, David, for you, and I'm going to oversimplify, so don't at me about this. It won't be exact, but this is basically what we're talking about. Banks are required to keep 10% of their deposits, shall we say, in the vault if you want your money back. They call them reserves. They keep them at the Fed. And for years, to set interest rates, the cost of the raw material for banks, what the Fed would do would be buy or sell reserves in the marketplace. If they became more scarce, banks didn't have enough reserves. They borrowed from other banks at that price. And as you can see here, it tracked the Fed's setting rate set pretty closely. The orange line is where the Fed wanted the rate to be, and this is where the buying and selling of reserves actually worked, although you can see it was a little volatile. But then what happened? We got to the financial crisis, and all of a sudden, the Fed needed to push rates below zero. They couldn't actually do that or didn't want to, so what they did was start QE, and we all remember that. And what happened there is they started buying a lot of bonds from banks. They gave bonds credit for those banks as reserve. They put the cash essentially in the Fed's vault. And what happens if you have a lot of cash and it gets into the economy? You end up with inflation. Didn't want that. So what they did was set a rate to pay banks to keep their money at the Fed, interest on excess reserves. And that's the purple line here. And as you can see, it set a ceiling for where the Fed funds rate would be. And they set a repo rate at the bottom. And as you can see, for years now, it has worked pretty well to keep the Fed funds rate in the middle of that range, much less volatility. So they decided this works better than the old way of doing it, scarcity of reserves. We're going to keep that system. How many reserves, though, do they need in order to keep the system working? Well, that's the question that we expect them to answer tomorrow. Now, on the Fed's balance sheet, they have both treasuries and mortgage bonds. Those are liabilities of the Fed. Treasuries and mortgages. Mortgages harder to get rid of because people can prepay them. It's hard to know what kind of rate roll-off they're going to have. So they've been bringing down, basically, on an administered basis, the number of treasuries. Now, if you take a look, and we'll bring up the other chart here, at the Fed's liabilities are the reserves they have on the system, in the system, and cash. Cash immutable. The demand for cash keeps rising. So you're going to start with about 1.5 million and eventually maybe get over 2 trillion. These are trillion, not million, in cash demand around the world. That doesn't change. So the amount of reserves is what's going to change on the balance sheet. Where do they bring that down to? The best guess, somewhere around $1 trillion in reserves. Banks want to keep reserves now because they also, under Dodd-Frank, have to have high quality liquid assets they can easily sell. What's the easiest, safest thing to have? Reserves. So the Fed's been trying to figure out how many they need. Tomorrow, we expect to get a decision on that. They'll tell us. And that will the implication for that for the markets is we will know how many the Fed treasuries the Fed needs to buy and sell in the future in order to keep that rate, that level steady. And so it will have implications for the markets. It will be important. And we'll see what we get tomorrow.